Hello, I'm Jim Richards. Thank you for joining me today. Got a powerful message I'm going to share with you. You don't even, I almost don't even know what to call this, but I'm calling it moment by moment resurrection. You say, what in the world can that mean? I'm going to tell you something. Walking in resurrection life, walking in kingdom living, it's moment by moment. There's never a one-time decision that you make that suddenly solves every problem you're going to face in the future. And somehow we've got this idea that if we ever one time prayed a prayer, if we ever one time made a commitment to Jesus, that suddenly everything goes to automatic pilot and it's just supposed to work. No, you know something? We are free will agents, man. God created us in His likeness and image. And every situation we face, we can connect with the power of the cross and experience resurrection life. And today, I tell you, I'm going to give you practical tips how in moment-by-moment situations, you can always experience the resurrection life of God and really break the power of sin or destruction in your life. You know, life is lived moment by moment, decision by decision. And when it comes to kingdom living, when it comes to experiencing the life of God in any circumstance, it's all about making the decisions in that circumstance to trust God. It's making the decisions so that what you do is based on the finished work of Jesus. Now, some people think, man, how can I do that? I mean, how in the world can I ever get to the place to where every decision is going to be made on the finished work of Jesus? Well, trust me, it's easier than you can ever imagine. You know, let me just mention this to you, by the way. If you've never read my book, Moving Your Invisible Boundaries, you just snag it up and read it, because it's going to teach you the fundamentals of living from your heart. Because once you get something in your heart, once you get a truth established in your heart, it just emerges effortlessly and continuously, and you're never trying to remember to do something. You're never trying to do the right thing. It's just always emerging from you. You know, and living in the kingdom, moment by moment, making decisions based on the Word of God, one of the most important decisions you've got to make, or make sure that you made, or maybe renew if you made it and you've kind of slipped away from it. See, the real issue here is Jesus Lord of your life. If Jesus is Lord of your life, then you have made a decision that says, no matter what happens, no matter what comes up, no matter what goes wrong, I am going to trust and follow Jesus, and I'm going to continually share in this resurrection life that I have in Jesus. And if that's truly the decision that you have made, and you're fully committed to that, you're going to find that learning to live in the kingdom at all times is going to be way easier than you ever thought it would be. Now remember, Jesus was our model. And again, I've said this so many times. When Jesus was on planet Earth, He had emptied Himself. He was still the Son of God, but He had emptied Himself to have the limitations of man. And the Bible says He was made like us in all ways so that He could be our high priest, so that He could be the captain of our salvation, so that in every way He would be compassionate, understand what we're going through, and know how to minister to us in every single situation. So even though I look to the cross to experience the power of God, I look to Jesus' life to understand what this looks like in day-to-day living. You know, Jesus had to learn the secret of dying to self. He came to planet Earth to accomplish a mission that God had sent Him on. But as a man, He had desires, and some people could struggle with that. See, Jesus had temptation, and you can't have temptation if you don't have desires. And Jesus showed us how to deal with temptation so that temptation never becomes sin. He was tempted in all ways like as we are, yet without sin. Remember, sin is not just what you do wrong. Sin is any aspect of seeing, experiencing yourself less than you really are in God's eyes, or living in a standard of life less than God desires for you to live. So Jesus learned the secret of dying to self. Listen to this in Hebrews 2:10. It says, it was fitting for Him for whom all things and by whom all things, and bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. You think, man alive, this is obviously talking about the cross. Yes, it's talking about the cross. But even more than that, it's talking about Jesus' willingness to go to the cross. In Hebrews 5:8, it says, though He was a son, yet He learned obedience by the things which He suffered. See, immediately people take this and go to some place about suffering that is just beyond what God really wants. Let me tell you the kind of suffering that God wants you to do and the kind of suffering that you are called to do. You are called to die to self so you can be alive to God. Now, I want you to realize Jesus was in the garden praying. He was saying this, "Let this cup pass from me." In other words, I don't want to do this. This is not my plan for my life. But see, he didn't stop there. It's all right that there's things you don't want to do. It's all right that there's things you don't want to do God's way. But at the end of it, the decision you've got to be willing to make if you're following Jesus as Lord. And if you want to experience resurrection life, is you've got to die to that desire to do it your way. And so Jesus said, listen, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. And then he said, but not my will, but your will be done. Now, I'll tell you, giving into the will of God never means you go through hardship the way religion has told us. It's not about being sick. It's not about your children dying. It's not about getting a disease. It's not about being broke. It's not about living in poverty. All of those things are the curse of the law. We're delivered from the curse of the law. Dying to self means dying to any sense of who you are outside of Christ. Dying to self means this person that you thought you were all of your life, with all those limitations, with all those hang-ups, and with all those failures, you got to die to that sense of self so that you can be alive to this new you in Jesus, this raised up in newness of life, this righteous you, this powerful you, this anointed you, this called and chosen and loved and accepted you. You see, you got to die to self daily. Or let me put it this way, die to self in every situation. The Apostle Paul said it in 1 Corinthians 15:3. He said, I affirm by the boasting in you, which I have in Christ Jesus, he's talking about the influence he had on their life, that I die daily. I want to tell you something. Paul was not talking about getting sick every day. You know, Paul was on the mission field. Man, he traveled all over the world. I've heard these goofy religious rumors that said Paul had an eye disease and was nearly blind. There is no historical evidence of that. There is no biblical evidence of that. That is just absolutely absurd. But the truth is, when Paul talked about his sufferings and talked about dying daily, yes, he went through some sufferings because he took the gospel to the world. But let me tell you something. If Paul had taken the gospel to the Gentiles, like God called them to do, instead of always going first to the Jews, he probably wouldn't have suffered quite so much. I want to tell you something. It doesn't matter if it's something. You know, one of the great things about the Bible is it shows you everything they did wrong. And that's not just so that we can look at it and criticize them. It's not just so that we can make excuses for ourselves. It means that we can realize, even with our frailties and our issues, we can still choose to be used of God. We can still choose to follow God. And even though our frailties and issues will make it difficult for us, it's never God making us difficult. You know, when Jesus died to self, it came down to not my will, but your will be done. I think the greatest way to understand dying to self, or even the concept of taking up your cross, is when, you know, your cross is when your will and God's will cross. And every time your will, what you want and what God says, are mainly how you see something and how God sees it. When those two things cross, then you've got to surrender your opinion. You've got to surrender how you see the situation to what God says. And in most cases, it's all about surrendering how you see yourself in any situation. You know, Matthew 16:24, Jesus said, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. In other words, this is about dying to self. It's not about dying to your dreams. You know, here's the thing that I found. Our basic dreams, we all want to be happy. You know, we want to be healthy. We want to have good relationships. We want to be loved. You know, all of us basically want the same thing. But all of us have found all of these different ways that we go about trying to get the things that we want. And when the way we're trying to get that is based on what we learned growing up, based on some corrupt idea that we have, based on a faulty sense of self, based on feeling inferior and limited, whenever we are pursuing these things independent of how God says they can come to us, then we're alive to self. We're alive to doing this my way. We're alive to doing this the way I see things. I'm alive to doing this based on who I think I really am instead of who God says I am in Jesus. So, you know, my opinion, God's opinion is going to cross, and that's when I've got to be like Jesus and say, you know what? Not my will, but your will be done. And you know what? You can't do that unless you believe that by the cross of Christ and by the fact that you are in Jesus, you died at the cross, setting you free from all the curses of the law. You were raised up from the tomb in Jesus, receiving the inheritance through him or in him, and therefore all the promises of God are yours. Once you know that God's a good God and all the promises are yours and all the provisions are yours through the Lord Jesus, then you come to this reality that God's never withholding anything from you. And the truth is you can have the very best that life has to offer by surrendering your opinion. And yet you might have some fear and trepidation because you've never done it another way. You know, you might have manipulated to get what you want your whole life. And finally, you're in a relationship or in a business situation. And you're deciding, I'm not going to manipulate. I'm not going to lie. And you know what? If that's the way you've always done it, it is really frightening to do it another way. But you know what? If you do that trusting God, even if that situation doesn't work out the way you want it to, your desires will get fulfilled. I tell you, God delights to give you the desire of your heart. I mean, that's just the Bible. God wants to give you the desire of your heart, Jesus, but you got to delight in him. And that means you walk before him circumspectly. You walk before him gently, always honoring his wisdom in the situation. So dying daily in real life really is going to get down to managing your thought life. You know, if you wait till you get to the behavior aspect of trying to solve a problem, you might have waited too late. You might not really be able to turn your situation around or turn your behavior around if you're already to that stage. Where we want to solve our problems is we want to solve our problems in the phase of how we think about every situation, because you're going to make decisions and you're going to live and think and function, or you're going to live and function and behave out of how you think. And how you think is going to drive your emotions. And you know good and well that if your emotions get in gear, you can end up going somewhere that you really had no intention of going. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 10 is one of those scriptures that the church has just taken out of context for as long as I've been a believer, which is over 40 years. And they have used 2 Corinthians 10 to talk about fighting with the devil. It has nothing to do with fighting with the devil. And remember, if you are in Jesus, then you were raised up with him. Satan, you were in him when Satan was stripped of power and put under his feet, and you are in him. Therefore, that battle is already won other than in your mind. So you don't have to fight with the devil. You just have to believe in the victory that you have because of what Jesus did. Listen to this. 2 Corinthians 10:3 says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh." In other words, yes, we're in this human body, but we're not going to fight our battles. And he's not talking about battles with the devil. He's talking, and you'll see clearly, King James says imaginations. You're going to see what that word really means. But he's talking about the battles or the struggles that go on in the inside of a person. And he says, we don't do that in the flesh. We don't do that with willpower. We don't just grit our teeth and try to make things work out the way we hope they'll work out. He's talking about facing life's daily struggles without getting into your own strength. Because, listen, the Bible says that the weakness of the law was the flesh. You know, the flesh is your ability, your strength, your five senses, the natural way of seeing things. The flesh is really bigger than just talking about this physical body here. So he says, look, I live in the flesh. I live in this body. But this is not the way I do business. It's not this strength and my natural thoughts and philosophies that I use to win the battles. He says, for the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal. They're not natural. They're not flesh. After the flesh is probably what that really means. But they are mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. And man, immediately when people start talking about strongholds, they go right to the devil. We got to fight with the devil. Let me tell you something. If you're fighting with the devil, then the truth is you are not confident in the finished work of Jesus. If you're fighting with the devil, then evidently you don't realize he has been stripped of all principality, power, and might, and is really not the issue in your life. By the way, if you're having struggles with the devil, if you're afraid of the devil, you get my book, Satan Unmasked, and you read that, and it'll show you what Jesus did at the cross. I got news for you. All of your fear and concern about the devil will be over. You see, we are in a war, but the war we're not in is not with the devil. That battle's already been won. We are in a war that's internal. It has to do with our thoughts, our feelings, our emotions, our mind, the way we think. It's always really a battle of between trusting what Jesus has accomplished at the cross or trusting my natural logic, my natural strength and abilities, and how I've always done things. That's what it's really talking about here when it refers to the flesh. So he says, the King James says here in verse 5, casting down imaginations. The New King James and all of the translations says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. So you see, our issue is that we have these arguments or these imaginations that really oppose or exalt themselves above the knowledge or the experience of God. Now remember, this series is about communion with Christ. And I know you're wondering, where in the world is that going to come in? Trust me, next week we're going to dive right straight into the first aspect of communion with Christ. But today we got to get you on some of the dealing with stuff on a daily basis. But you see, what we experience in God and what, even though you may experience it just briefly, even though it may be just momentarily, even though it may be just fleeting, the truth is there's always going to be thoughts based on your culture, your religion, your upbringing, what your parents taught you, your fears, what you think your strengths are, basically the old man, who you think you are. Because if you're not absolutely solid in the fact that your old man died in Christ, then you really can't take on any awareness of who you are as a new man. Now, I know I'm mentioning a lot of my books today, but for some reason it's just coming out, and you know, I only do this when I feel inspired to do this. But you know, if you're struggling with your sense of leaving the old man behind, you might want to get my book about becoming the person you want to be. Because this is all about being who you really are in Jesus instead of being who you think you are. And it's all about how to win that battle. So here's the deal. You're facing a situation, and in this situation, an imagination, a thought, basically emerges in the form of an argument. Actually, that word there is closely related to the Greek word logos, which has to do with a reasoning or a logic. So he's saying there's a reasoning, there's a logic, there's an argument in you that says, yes, God's word may say this, but in this situation, I really feel like I've got to handle this way. You have now gone to the flesh. You're now trying to win your battle in the flesh, and you can't do it. You know, when you sow a seed from the flesh, it just produces a crop of the flesh. And I got news for you. Any seed, every seed bears after its own kind. You sow seeds from the Spirit, the Word, the truth. I got news for you. It's always going to bring back life and peace and joy. You sow seeds in the flesh, it's always going to bring back chaos and trouble. And then you're going to be praying for God to deliver you from the trouble that you made. But let me tell you something. God's there to deliver you. God never quits trying to deliver. It doesn't matter how many stupid mistakes you make. God is always for you. He's never against you. He's never going to leave you, even though everybody else would. Even though your mother, your father, everybody's finally just says, I'm done with you. You've gone too far. I've had it with you. I can't put up with anything else out of you. I got news for you. God never does that. Never, ever, ever, ever does that. But you have to realize something. God cannot deliver you from your own choices. If you choose something that brings pain in your life, pain's going to come in your life. Now, God can try to comfort you. He can try to help you. He can try to lead you out of it. He can try to lead you into better decisions. But if you keep making decisions from the flesh, in other words, what you think your strengths are, what you think your weaknesses are, what your mama taught you, what church taught you, what your daddy taught you, what everybody said about you, what your grades were in school, all of that stuff that has to do with who you believe you are, your sense of self, the old man. If you make decisions based on all those things, you will just keep ending up in the same place over and over and over again. So what do you do with this logic? What do you do with this reasoning that makes so much sense based on the way you've always done it. Here's what you do. Bringing every thought. Now, you see, this is about thoughts. This is not about the devil. This is about thoughts. You can scream at the devil all day long, but if you don't win the victory over your thoughts, you're gonna lose the battle, because just thinking that the devil is your problem is a vain imagination. It says, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Now, man, how many times have I read that scripture and really, in my own mind, thought it said, I've got to make my thoughts obey Christ. That's not what it says. And boy, you start trying to control your thoughts and force yourself to think a certain way. I got news for you, particularly if you're trying not to think something. You can't stop thinking about something by trying to not think about it. Because in order to try to not think about it, you've got to think about it. You can't win the battle that way. And what this verse is really talking about is shifting from what you think you can do in your own strength, shifting from what you think you can do in your flesh, and from that position, moving into what Jesus accomplished through his obedience. Where is it talking about his obedience? I'll tell you where it's talking about: his obedience to the cross. His obedience to experience death, burial, and resurrection for you. Jesus accomplished things for us through his obedience. And when we bring our thoughts in line with what he accomplished through his obedience, then we experience the grace of God. We experience resurrection life. We experience the same spirit of resurrection that raised Jesus from the dead, raising us up from the dead. Listen, I'm going to be back with you in just a moment for a mentoring moment. Be sure and don't go away, because you want to get this. This is going to be some really, really practical stuff. You know, one of the things that the church has never searched out, never understood, I've never heard it preached much. And that, as a matter of fact, I don't know if I've ever heard it preached at all, but you see, Jesus became sin. Now, he never committed sin, but he became sin according to the scriptures. And having become sin, when he died, he went to Hades. Now, Hades is not hell. It's not the lake of fire and brimstone, but it is the abode of death of those who died alienated from God. When he was on the cross and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He wasn't just quoting scripture. This was his experience. I've heard people say, no, that was just a mistake. No, it wasn't a mistake. He had to experience everything that we would have experienced had we had to stand before God in our sin. Now, when Jesus dies and goes to Hades in sin, the scripture shows us this incredible model of what he did to overcome, because he brought his faith alive. He activated his faith. And the book of Jonah, all throughout Jonah, Jonah keeps talking about what he went through while he was in the belly of the fish. And he'll say, I was down at the depths of the earth. But he would say, but I shall worship God. I shall stand in his temple. Da, 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 da. You know, my soul was overcome. The seaweed was about my head. I almost gave up. But I shall worship God. I shall do this. And Jonah was a type of Jesus. And there are other scriptures that give us a type of Jesus. We just don't have time to go into them all right now. But as much as I can understand it, when Jesus was dead and had become my sin, he began to acknowledge what God said about him. He began to acknowledge, I am a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. You are my Father, and you shall not leave my soul in Hades, neither shall my body suffer corruption. For I am your son, and you have made my enemies a footstool. I reign in a throne of righteousness, and righteousness is my scepter. And so he acknowledged these things about really who God said he was. And because of that, he used his faith. And the Bible says he was raised up by faith, by the faith of the Lord Jesus. Well, we are raised up. Every time we face a situation where it seems like death and destruction and pain and despair and poverty and sickness is going to win, that's when we have to go to what God says about us because we're in Jesus. You see, because I am in Jesus, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am more than a conqueror in Christ. I am qualified for all of the inheritance because I am in Christ. You see, when the Bible talks about being in Christ, this is not just being vague. This is not accidental. Everything that we have because we are in Christ. So in every situation that I'm facing, I have to immediately acknowledge that, whatever I'm facing, I've got to ask myself this question. Is this a curse of the law? And if it's a curse of the law, then I have to say, you are not from God. You are not for me. I resist you. I do not accept you. I send you away. And that's got to be a choice. It doesn't happen automatically. That's got to be your choice. See, no curse has the right to come on you, but you're the one that has to exercise your own faith. And then you begin to acknowledge in this situation, this is exactly, or I'm a new creation in Christ. When Jesus came up out of the grave, he overcame you. So I have overcome you because this is who I am in Jesus. And we begin to acknowledge who we are in Jesus. And I'll tell you, your heart will turn.